was a Chelsea morning, and the first thing that I heard.
It's Sunday morning on CBS, and here again is Charles Osgood.
Chelsea Morning was just one of the songs that made Joni Mitchell a star back in the late 1960s. Today she is still refining her art and expanding her repertoire. Russ Mitchell offers this Sunday profile.
Let me ask you a big picture question here. I'm going to read from a bio of you from a rock music writer. When the dust settles, Joni Mitchell may stand as the most important and influential female recording artist of the late 20th century. When you hear something like that, what goes through your head?
Only the late 20th century?
Help me, I think I'm falling in love again.
She's kidding, of course, but Joni Mitchell has had a career few artists can imagine.
Don't it always seem to go? You don't know what you've got till it's gone. They paid paradise, put up a parking lot.
Roberta Joan Anderson was born in 1943 to an Alberta, Canada grocer and a school teacher. As a young girl, she was happiest outdoors, but much of her early life was marred by illness.
Well, I would have been an athlete.
You would have been an athlete.
And I got polio, and I got several killer diseases between 8 and 9, like in a row, scarlet fever, severe chickenpox. I was shipped to another city, so I was kind of battling it on my own. And I was in a room with a 6-year-old boy who was very depressed. And so I would sing. That's when I started singing. And
how old were you?
I was 9.
You were 9. You started singing.
Yeah. And he told me to shut up. So it wasn't, I had a heckler for my first audience.
The wind is in from Africa.
Young Joni soon discovered that she could make singing pay. Unable to afford a guitar, she bought a baritone ukulele for $36 and taught herself to play. But music, it turns out, was not her first love.
I was always going to be a painter. This was just kind of sideline. When I went to art school, I got a gig at the Depression Coffee House, which, you know, I had to pay my own way to art school, or I had to back it up with my... So I had no money for movies or bowling, which I liked also. And... Or cigarettes, which I've smoked since I was 9. So
since you were 9 years old?
Yeah. So, you know, the music, I played in coffee houses for $15 a night, and $15 had some buying power back then. You know, it gave me a little bit of income. And I was just singing folk songs then. I hadn't really put it all together, so I didn't think of myself as particularly talented. I hadn't really come up with anything particularly original.
Everything comes and goes, marked by lovers and stars.
And success did not come easily. In 1965, she was out of work and pregnant by an old college boyfriend. After the child was born, she married fellow folk singer Chuck Mitchell, who promised support for Joni and her baby. But within 2 years, the marriage crumbled. Unemployed and penniless, Joni Mitchell gave her baby girl up for adoption. And poured her soul into music that would help define a generation.
Is there a song when you think back on it and say, wow, that song is the first song I wrote that I'm incredibly proud of?
Well, I never was really... The first song that got fussed over was Both Sides Now, which I thought was a failure because it was such a big meditation, you know. I've looked at, you know, these things from both sides now. I do clouds from up in the air looking down and down on the ground looking up and all the things that they do.
I've looked at clouds from both sides now, from up and down, and still somehow.
I was 21 when I wrote that, and I got mostly ridicule from people for, what do you know about life? You're 21, you know.
Huh. But
actually, at 21, I had experienced quite a lot of life. I'd had a rough childhood. You know, but I looked so innocent, but I was very, you know, I'd had life and death struggles.
Paradise, put up a parking lot.
By the 1970s, Joni Mitchell was an artist who seemed to have just the right voice at just the right time.
Don't it always seem to go? You don't know what you've got till it's gone. Paradise, put up a parking lot.
The thing that gave me the most pain in life, you know, psychologically, and it gave me tremendous pain psychologically, is man's disrespect for nature.
That was the first issue that really got to you.
It's basically been the pain of my life, is the stupidity of the human animal in its relationship to the planet.
They paid paradise, put up a parking lot. They paid paradise, put up a parking lot.
She has written and recorded songs that have been more than just hits. A Joni Mitchell song says something and means something. And Joni Mitchell is here to sing for us.
I'm always burning behind the time.
In the years that followed, Joni Mitchell became one of the most influential artists of all time, with 5 Grammys and a place in the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame. She also reunited with the daughter she gave up for adoption. But she was getting fed up with the music business, and in 2002, said she was dropping out.
Was it easy to say, I quit?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
You know.
Yeah.
It was a great relief.
It also meant more time for her first love, visual art.
You shot all of these on a disposable camera?
Yeah.
On your flat screen TV?
Yeah. Which was distracting in, I think, a very interesting graphic manner. This is Tiananmen Square.
Uh-huh.
Looks like a cabbage, really. But
at an exhibition in New York City last month, she showed art she'd created by snapping photos of the often violent images that appeared on her home TV.
And this all came from a malfunctioning TV. Is that
yes.
Correct?
Yeah. Somebody said, well, Joan, you know, you had a lemon and you made lemonade. This is...
If you can keep your head.
And earlier this year, the music began to well up inside her once again.
People are losing theirs and blaming you. If you can trust yourself.
Was there a time where you thought you would never get back into this? You weren't going to record again?
Oh, yeah.
That was it?
Up until the songs started to come this year.
Yeah.
And when they came, I kept going, oh, no, not another one. It wasn't like I kept giving birth, because I said, I'm never going to do social commentary again. I'm never going to do this.
Really? Wow.
Yeah.
You had no desire to get back into the game?
No. No.
Now that you're back in it, you're okay with it?
Yeah. It's just something I had to go through.
Shine on all the fishermen with nothing in their nets.
Her new album, Shine, debuted in September.
Shine on rising oceans and evaporating seas.
And after a long absence, Joni Mitchell returned to the stage in L.A. last weekend for a Thelonious Monk Institute tribute to her friend, Herbie Hancock.
She plants her garden in the spring.
Herbie Hancock called you a great jazz singer, among other things.
Yes.
What do you call yourself?
I can't tell. I don't like to be labeled too much. It's too static. I'm a very fluid kind of person. I can't think of a label. Anything I might call myself, I might not be that tomorrow. I don't have any desire to perform, but I really have a desire to do ballets. You know, I love that concept.
And yet again, her concept has become reality. The Fiddle and the Drum is a collaboration with the Alberta Ballet. In this production, the dancers move, as the world has done for more than 40 years, to the rhythms of Joni Mitchell.
I am not a lonely road, and I am traveling, 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 traveling. Something, what can it be? Oh, I hate you, son. I hate you, son.